introduce those of you who haven't met him yet, Jason Gendler, who's visiting us from Southern California for our two-year visiting assistant professor position in global cinema. Jason got his bachelor's degree from the University of Wisconsin, where he worked closely with David Bordwell. Think back to film art, for those of you reading film history, that David Bordwell. From Wisconsin, he moved on to UCLA, where he got his master's degree and his PhD. His dissertation was on the beginnings of mainstream Hollywood films, and that'll be his first book. Jason's current research is focused in two directions. The first, Hong Kong cinema, and the second is narratives in serialized television, research that he's going to present to us today. So please join me in welcoming Jason.
Hi, everybody. Thanks. So I'll just get right into it. So today I'm going to talk about how television creates psychologically rich situations, which are those moments where we can make a lot of distinctive and sophisticated inferences about the mental states of characters. So in other words, what's going on inside their heads in terms of their character psychology. This is a subject that a lot of television scholars have seized on as one of the unique appeals of television, television narratives. Their long-running lengths provide us opportunities for making extremely rich and rewarding inferences about the mental states of characters. Following characters over long periods of time provide us with increased ability to understand the complexity of their interior states because viewers have accumulated a great deal of knowledge and information about the characters. We feel like we know them and what's going on in their head, in their lives. Two kinds of information are particularly important for understanding the complexity of the characters' thought processes. The first is their personality traits, also known as dispositions. And the second is knowledge of characters' previous mental states, how the character thought and felt about previous situations in the story. When we can use both of these kinds of information to understand a character's behavior in a given scene, we're much more likely to have a better understanding of exactly what's going on inside the heads of characters. Jason Mattel, for instance, writes that, this is a big one, an ongoing serial portraying a community of characters interacting and reacting to one another becomes a particularly fertile ground to explore interiority. Over the course of a serial, the characters whom we are aligned with, connected to, and invested in are typically those that we spend the most time attached to, and it would provide us the most interesting interior states, balancing inscrutable access with complex dimensionality to engage us as active mind readers. So given the potentially large amount of character knowledge that viewers accumulate over the course of a television program, especially serialized programs where the characters' stories continue across episodes from week to week, it's easy to assume that television narratives would routinely call on all of the knowledge we've accumulated in order to create psychologically rich situations that engage and reward viewers. So today we're going to test this assumption by examining how a season of a moderately serialized television show actually creates psychologically rich situations. And in particular, we're going to look at three things. First is the degree to which episodes of television series create rich situations through information established within the individual episode itself. I call this episodic enrichment. So this refers to when we see a really complex scene between characters, and the complexity is the result of information introduced only in that episode itself. And we're going to look at how this compares with serial enrichment, which is the degree to which complex scenes are created by relying on information that we've learned in previous episodes. So if a situation is serially enriched, it means it uses information that we learned in different episodes give insight into the character's mental states. And the third thing we're going to look at is the extent to which episodic and serial information are blended together in a given situation. This is what I'll call blended enrichment. So this is when a scene uses both information from the current episode and information from previous episodes to boost the complexity of our inferences. We'll also explore how the ratio between these three different kinds of enrichment might shift depending on where a given episode is located in a season. So the goal here is to discover precisely how television makes use of what some scholars have deemed to be one of television's unique appeals, and to explain why the situation that employs serial knowledge can have such a powerful effect on viewers. And we'll also learn about how season-long distribution patterns in these different kinds of enrichment support the idea of a television season as a narrative unit, and how a show can accommodate both experienced and inexperienced. And we're going to explore these issues through an analysis of the fifth season of Mad Men. I've chosen Mad Men because the series excels, oh, this is kind of hard to hard to see even. I've chosen Mad Men because the series excels at creating psychologically rich situations. It routinely, can we get the lights off?
Yeah, at least turn them down.
Great, let's do that. Mad Men excels at creating psychologically rich situations. It routinely prompts us to, read the minds of the characters with great insight. And I've chosen season 5 in particular because it's in the latter half of the series, which ran for 7 seasons, and so it has a lot of material from previous seasons to call on to create complex psychological situations. So to give you an idea of what I mean by serial enrichment, let's begin by examining a situation enriched by serial info. In episode 9, entitled Dark Shadows, Betty is helping her daughter Sally with a family tree school project while also sorting through her son Bobby's schoolwork. Eventually, she comes across a love note scrawled on the back of one of Bobby's drawings from her ex-husband Don to his new wife Megan. Alright, so even if you've never seen the show before, you can probably tell that Betty is trying to sow discord here and to make Don upset, both on her physical reaction to the letter and on knowing that she and Don are divorced. However, our ability to understand Betty's interiority in this scene, her motivations, her emotions, and her goals, is greatly enriched by knowledge acquired over previous episodes, particularly Betty's personality traits or dispositions, and the many previous inferences we made about her mental states. For one, Betty's behavior here is informed by her chronic unhappiness, a disposition which often causes her to try to ruin other people's happiness. More significantly, though, in past episodes, we've been able to infer that Betty has been envious of what she thinks has been Don's quick recovery from their divorce and insecure about her inability to get a rise out of him. Those previous inferences make it rather clear that reading this love letter arouses those same feelings again. Moreover, previous episodes have also demonstrated that Don wants to hide his complicated past from his kids, and that Betty has a habit of using their children to try to upset him. All of this serial knowledge informs Betty's behavior in this scene, enriching our understanding of it and contributing to its psychological complexity. Regular viewers know with great specificity exactly why the note is upsetting to Betty, and they're in a good position to make fairly accurate hypotheses about how she's going to react to it. She'll try to hurt Don back, without any regard for the effect her ploy will have on her daughter's well-being. So this scene is enriched and made more complex by calling on knowledge of character behavior accumulated over previous episodes. However, in practice, many individual episodes of this season of Mad Men don't rely on information from previous episodes to create psychologically rich situations. Instead, many situations are psychologically enriched through the information established within an individual episode itself, far more frequently than they are enriched through information we've learned from previous episodes. For instance, in the 8th episode, Lady Lazarus, Peggy, Don's protege copywriter at the ad agency where most of the characters work, has caught Don's new wife, Megan, in a lie about where she was, where she spent an evening. And Peggy is placed in an awkward position where she has to either avoid Don or lie to him. And when Peggy confronts Megan, Megan reveals that she lied in order to go on an audition. To our surprise, Megan wants to be an actress rather than an advertising copywriter, but she's afraid, rightly, that telling Don will jeopardize his love for her. Peggy doesn't want to hear this. She's unsympathetic. And she's angry that Megan has jeopardized Peggy's ability to be honest with Don. And the scene concludes with Peggy exasperated and Megan distraught. And what follows next is one of the most psychologically rich and complex scenes in the entire episode, but it's a product more or less exclusively of the episodic information established in these previous scenes. Okay, so based on Megan's discomposure in the previous scene, we can infer that her sunny demeanor here is a performance, one that speaks to her aspirations as an actor. We can also infer that Megan's composure solicits irritation and contempt from Peggy because Peggy knows it's an act, and because Peggy now thinks Megan is ungrateful for her position at the agency. When Megan literally acts out the cool whip pitch with Don, we can make some complex inferences about Peggy's reaction. Her annoyance with Megan is exasperated further exacerbated because Megan is reinforcing twice over her performative aspirations and because Don and the others are so easily seduced by her performances, both in the pitch and in her role as contented copywriter. Additionally, when Peggy blurts out, "Just taste it," Don and the others are pleased because they think her reaction is evidence of the tagline's effectiveness, little realizing that Peggy's interruption was prompted more by Megan's double performance than by the pitch itself. We can also infer that Peggy's pointed question about Don and Megan performing in the ad is meant to reiterate Peggy's displeasure with Megan, but in a way that only Megan can understand. And finally, we can also infer that Peggy's question has had the desired effect. Megan looks like she's been scolded as she watches Peggy leave Don's office while Don smiles obliviously. The inferences we make about Peggy and Megan's mental states in this scene are undoubtedly rich, given their sophistication, their nuance, and their precision. Yet they're nearly entirely the product of information introduced over the course of this individual episode, rather than previous episodes. And this scene is not an odd outlier of how Mad Men create psychologically rich situations, but is in fact relatively typical. 27 minutes, or 57.5% of this episode, relies more or less exclusively on episodic information to enrich our understanding of characters' mental states, while only 16.5 minutes, or 35.5%, relies on a mixture of serial and episodic info. The remaining 3 minutes are psychologically poor situations where we don't have enough information to make sophisticated inferences We're left curious about what's going on in the Carrington Mental States. All of these scenes prominently feature Megan behaving suspiciously or duplicitously before she reveals her actions to Peggy. And most of the episodes in season 5 are structured this way. In 9 of the season's 13 episodes, over half of each episode's running length is enriched exclusively through episodic info. And on average, those 9 episodes are enriched by episodic information 62.5% of the time, the most being 80% in episode 3, and the least being 54% in episode 7. And over the course of all 13 episodes of this season, the average drops to 55%, still more than half the time. So these are a lot of numbers, but the basic idea here is that, as a whole, the season creates psychologically gripped situations, mostly through relying on episodic knowledge. Moreover, the vast majority of the time, not only in Lady Lazarus, but throughout the entire season, serial information is rarely used exclusively to enrich the psychology of the situation. Throughout the entire season, there are only 3 scenes that could be understood only in terms of the dispositions and inferences established in previous episodes, each of them very brief. The longest one is only 35 seconds. So instead, it's much more common for serial info to contribute to a scene's psychological richness by being blended with inferences that we make about, blended with episodic info. So in other words, if a scene is going to call on serial info to enrich the inferences we make about a character's mental state, usually it's also going to call upon info established earlier in that particular episode as well. So for example, the Dark Shadow scene between Betty and Sally is not enriched solely through serial information, but it calls on episodic info too. Earlier in the episode, Betty goes to Don and Megan's apartment to pick up Sally and the other children. Betty is already self-conscious about her recent weight gain, and she's envious of Megan's slimness. But she's irritated further when Megan kisses Betty's kids goodbye and feels threatened by the idea of being replaced by Megan in her children's lives. So when Betty tells Sally about Anna Draper, this situation is further enriched by episodic knowledge. Betty is not only throwing a wrench into Don's happiness, but she's also devaluing Megan in Sally's eyes, making Megan seem like just another woman that Don has married rather than a potential new mother. So one question raised by these observations: if one of the appeals of serialized television narratives is that they can call upon information from previous episodes to enrich the psychology of a given scene, then why does season 5 of Mad Men so often rely on blended enrichment rather than serial enrichment? Well, one obvious disadvantage of relying solely on serial knowledge is that it could make episodes difficult to follow, especially if they air in weekly installments, as the gaps between episodes could make recalling previous info more difficult. And indeed, a lot of contemporary series guard against this possibility by airing a montage that recaps recent relevant developments from previous episodes before the start of a given one. Moreover, from the perspective of a television network, a show that relies exclusively on serial enrichment would likely have difficulty attracting new viewers who would be at a loss to understand the episode's developments. Conversely, blended enrichment appeals more easily to both experienced and inexperienced viewers. Serialized information rewards longtime viewers by calling on their shared history with characters to enrich their understanding of the situation, while episodic information appeals to these same viewers by introducing variety into the narrative lives of the characters, providing the characters with new situations to react to, and providing experienced viewers with new situations through which to apply their extensive serial knowledge of character dispositions to quickly anticipate and understand a character's behavior. For inexperienced viewers, the situation is enriched by episodic information. Those situations are appealing because their richness can be easily understood, even without having seen previous episodes, while enriching scenes through a combination of serialized and episodic info can pique their curiosity, encouraging them to go back and watch previous episodes to fully enjoy the richness of a scene that they're watching. And this has become relatively easy to accomplish given recent industrial shifts toward diverse distribution formats, DVDs, and especially streaming video services. However, there still remains the question, why do so many episodes largely call on episodic rather than blended info to create psychologically rich situations, especially considering that Mad Men Season 5 has 4 previous seasons of material to work with. After all, this reliance on episodic information is more than just a matter of television series consistently needing to develop new episodic conflicts to sustain narratives over the course of many episodes and seasons, because even episodic storylines can be enriched by information from previous episodes. For instance, Betty's attempt to sow discord into Don's life in Dark Shadows is a relatively episodic plot. She devises her plan in this episode, and the consequences of her actions play out and are largely resolved over the course of its length. Yet, as we've seen, the moment-to-moment character behavior here is greatly enriched by serial information from previous episodes. So it's insufficient to appeal to this show's reliance on episodic plot lines to explain why so many episodes infrequently call back on previous info to enrich our understanding of characters' mental states. A more compelling answer is offered by examining the pattern that emerges from the entirety of Mad Men's fifth season. So while it's true that the majority of episodes are largely episodically enriched, most of these episodes are located in the first half of the season. As the season progresses, situations tend to be increasingly enriched through a combination of both serial and episodic info. Episode 9 is significant, as it's the first episode in the season where more time is devoted to scenes that blend serial and episodic information than to scenes that call on only episodic information. However, it's part of a larger pattern, culminating in the final two episodes of the season, where over 70% of each episode's situations are enriched through a blend of episodic and serial knowledge. We can account for this gradual shift, and for why the majority of episodes are enriched episodically rather than through a blend of serial and episodic knowledge by examining more closely how plot lines are parceled out throughout the season. For one, many of the early episodes have relatively self-contained plot lines, where the inferences that we make about the characters' mental states neither call upon our knowledge of previous mental states nor contribute to the enrichment of situations in subsequent episodes. So for example, in the second episode, Lane finds a wallet left by a stranger in a taxi, and in the process of returning it, he strikes up a flirtation with his owner, the owner of the wallet's mistress. So this plot is constricted entirely to this episode. It's never mentioned again, and it neither leads viewers to make inferences that enrich situations in subsequent episodes, nor reveals any new dispositions that Lane might possess, as season 4 already established Lane's willingness to engage in extramarital affairs. At the most, featuring an early season plot focusing on Lane, a character of merely moderate importance thus far, indirectly prepares viewers for the increased importance he's going to have through the end of the season. But this episodic plot is characteristic of a considerable number of plots introduced in the first 8 episodes, including Sally spending a night with her grandmother-in-law, Don and Harry trying to sign the Rolling Stones to a commercial, Peggy inviting Don's secretary to spend the night at her apartment, Pete and Trudy hosting a dinner party for Don, Ken, and their wives, and Pete flirting with a girl in his driving class. However, later in the season, more plot lines are introduced that carry over into subsequent episodes, and which create more opportunities for psychologically rich situations that call on knowledge and inferences we've made in previous episodes. So 3 significant plot lines stand out. These are Pete's affair, Lane's embezzlement of agency money, and the agency's pursuit of Jaguar, all introduced in episodes 8 and 10. These 3 plots create a lot of opportunities to make inferences about the characters' mental states, and throughout the remainder of the season, they're going to yield a lot of situations enriched through a blend of episodic and serial knowledge, in turn reducing the ratio of situations enriched only through episodic info. So a lot of situations involving Lane will be enriched by his struggle to keep his embezzlement a secret, while many situations involving Pete will be enriched by his infatuation with his mistress, and many situations involving Joan and her interaction with other characters will be enriched by her agreeing to prostitute herself to a Jaguar representative in exchange for a junior partnership at the agency. So you can see a lot from just those 3 plot lines. But in addition to multi-episode arcs introduced late in the season, there are also 2 other kinds of plot lines that also contribute to the trend toward increased serial enrichment as the season progresses. These are plots introduced early in the season, or even in previous seasons, but that lie dormant until later episodes, which are then serially enriched by inferences viewers made about the earlier episodes or seasons, and plots that yield a blend of episodic and serial enrichment throughout the entire season. Episodes 3 and 9 provide an example of the former kind of plot. Episode 3 introduces a seasonal storyline in which Betty has gained weight and is embarrassed by her appearance. However, after its introduction, this plotline remains dormant until episode 9, where earlier inferences about Betty's dissatisfaction with her weight gain greatly enrich many of her scenes. For instance, this serial enrichment is particularly evident when she gives herself an impromptu tour of Don and Megan's new apartment while waiting to pick up her kids. Moments before the clip I'm about to play begins, Betty checks her appearance in a mirror and sucks in her gut before approaching the door.
We were waiting.
So when Betty accidentally spies Megan dressing in the bedroom, it arouses in Betty a complex set of emotions that can be understood through a blend of both serial and episodic knowledge. It's clear from her behavior cues that she's self-conscious about seeing something she shouldn't. This is episodic enrichment. But she also compares herself with Megan and is both appreciative and envious of Megan's slim beauty and ashamed over her own recently increased weight, which is serial and episodic enrichment. This same kind of serial enrichment from a previously dormant seasonal plotline also applies to another plot involving Joan's family life and her divorce from her husband, as well as a plotline introduced in previous seasons concerning the repercussions of Don's having stolen the real Don Draper's name. And finally, the higher ratio of blended to episodic situations in later episodes can also be attributed to plot lines that span the length of the entire season, and which are present in nearly every episode. Two of the season's most prominent plots concern the tenor of Don and Megan's marriage and its effect on Don's efforts at work, and Peggy's career trajectory and her relationship with Don. Nearly every episode touches on the former, while the latter is developed in all but four episodes. Now, broadly speaking, these two plots, Don's love life and Peggy's career, are central to the entire series, featuring prominently in each of the show's seven seasons. So in season five, they often lend themselves to serially enriched situations in both early and late episodes. Indeed, these two plot lines can account for a significant portion of the early enrichment, or the serial enrichment in the early episodes of the season, although often these episodes are also, the serial enrichment is also a product of their touching on other developments that aren't featured consistently across the entire season, but which stretch back in previous seasons, like Don's past as Dick Whitman, the agency's recovery after losing the Lucky Strike account, and Don's relationship with his kids and Betty. Moreover, these season-long plots also build to climaxes that draw on both information accumulated over the course of the season, as well as information from previous seasons, making these later episodes doubly serially enriched. In the case of Don and Megan, their marriage is derailed when Megan quits the agency to pursue her acting career in episode 8, in turn shattering Don's illusions about who he thought he married. Many situations in the latter half of the season are serially enriched, both through his gradually waning romantic interest in her and his gradually waxing resentment of her, as well as his gradual return to old patterns of behavior from his marriage to Betty in seasons 1 through 3. He prioritizes work over family, he spends late nights at the office, he disregards his wife's wants and needs, and so on. This plotline climaxes at the very end of the season finale with an incredibly rich situation that calls upon both the trajectory of Don and Megan's marriage over the course of the season, as well as his destructive behavior during his marriage to Betty. He finally appears to be on the cusp of succumbing to the temptations of an extramarital affair. And I think you can play it. Let's play it. It's part of a larger montage, so I'm going to skip part of it. So here's Don on the set of a shoe commercial he cast Megan in, and he walks away from her. The marriage is essentially over for him. End of the season. It ends right there, right? So cumulative serial knowledge of Don's behavior enriches this situation to such a great degree that it seems eminently clear he's going to respond affirmatively. And indeed, the premiere of season 6 reveals him to be in the throes of yet another affair, albeit with a different woman. In the case of Peggy's career trajectory and her relationship with Don, Peggy inquires increasingly greater responsibility from Don as the season progresses, But Don also backslides in his behavior with her, treating her roughly as he has in seasons past, even after they achieve newfound heights of intimacy in season 4. This plotline climaxes in episode 11 in a very rich scene where Peggy tells Don she's leaving him to work at another ad agency, explicitly referencing the depth of their shared history over the previous 4 seasons. So in sum then, the later episodes more prominently feature situations enriched by a blend of episodic and serial info, because these episodes tend to make more and more use of the knowledge viewers have accumulated over previous episodes. Building to a climax that reaches a resolution or a new phase of development in plot lines that were initiated in late season episodes featured throughout the entire season or were initiated at earlier points in the season or carried over from previous seasons but that have lain dormant until near the season's end. These observations about seasonal patterns in blended and episodic enrichment yield some interesting theoretical implications. For one, these patterns provide further cause to consider a season of television as a narrative unit, independent of the many industrial considerations that also support such a division. So even though Mad Men's serialization carries across seasons, season 5 is structured as a partly self-contained, unified segment of a larger serialized narrative, with later episodes increasingly calling out information from previous episodes as the season draws to a close and resolves, to a degree, some of its serialized storylines. This internal coherence is unsurprising, considering that television writers often conceive of seasons in precisely this fashion, mapping out narrative arcs of a season ahead of time. However, this seasonal unity is further bolstered by another pattern in the season's use of serial enrichment, namely the degree to which serial knowledge enriching a scene originates from the current episode, or the current season, rather, versus the degree to which such knowledge originates from previous seasons. So as season 5 progresses, scenes that call upon serial knowledge tend to draw more and more from previous episodes within the current season, rather than from previous seasons, providing a strong indication of the degree to which the season's prominent narrative arcs are self-contained. And the reason for this trend, I think, is rather self-evident. When the season is still young, there are fewer previous episodes to call upon to enrich a given scene. So for instance, by necessity, all of the serial knowledge in episode 1 makes reference to knowledge from season 4 or further behind, because there aren't any previous season 5 episodes to call upon. There's nothing there yet. However, later episodes have increasingly more information from season 5 to call on to enrich scenes. We first start seeing some scenes that call on information from previous season 5 episodes, starting in episode 3, and it's only in episode 6 that we consistently begin to see scenes referring exclusively to serial knowledge from the current season. And by the last episode of the season, most of the serially enriched situations draw from information accumulated over the course of season 5 rather than the previous seasons, providing a strong sense of the season as a largely self-contained unit of a larger narrative. So in other words, the end of the season deals mostly with plot lines set up over the course of season 5 rather than plots from seasons past, lending further credence to the notion of a season as a unit of narrative. More significantly though, the trend of increased seriality near the end of the season also suggests that serial enrichment is instrumental in providing viewers with a strong sense of closure. Plot lines that call back on previous info in the process of resolving and the sense of closure they provide can be more fully realized by incorporating distant and cumulative serial knowledge. Thus, the power of scenes that resolve, at least temporarily, long-standing plots or arcs, such as the scene where Peggy leaves Don for another agency, or the final scene of the season where Don is on the verge of submitting to the temptations of yet another affair. Such scenes are powerfully engaging because they call on our knowledge, our serial knowledge, reaching back to the start of the series. Television scholars have noted that long-term engagement with characters yields strong emotional responses from viewers, and this pattern of blended and episodic enrichment throughout season 5 of Mad Men can help to explain why. The relative scarcity of blended situations early on can make their impact later in the season felt all the more, bolstering the satisfaction we get out of the story resolutions by having those resolutions call on past information. Conversely, the heightened impact of serially enriched plot resolutions could also explain why serial enrichment is less common at the start of season 5. The beginning of the season sets up seasonal plot arcs and extends series long arcs rather than resolving them, so thus its greater reliance on episodic enrichment. the beginning of the season is designed to entice viewers to invest in a show by making it by making character interiority easier to understand without having seen prior episodes, perhaps to lure in new viewers, whereas the end of the season rewards their investment through serial enrichment. And finally, these findings also suggest that the ability of long-running television series to call back on previous info to enrich scenes accounts for only some of the reasons for why characters in serialized television narratives are so engaging. The predominance of episodically enriched situations in season 5 of Mad Men and the depth and sophistication such scenes can offer would seem to suggest that just as important is television's ability to convey subtle shifts in the way characters engage with one another on a day-to-day basis, regardless of whether or not a given situation calls back to previous episodes, as in scenes like those where Don and Megan perform the Cool Whip pitch under Peggy's baleful eye. So in other words, perhaps just as important as serial enrichment for engaging viewers is television's ability to convey the fabric of small-scale, day-to-day interactions between characters. Okay, so I'm going to conclude now. In conclusion, many individual episodes of season 5 of Mad Men create scenes where we can make complex inferences about a character's mental states, not by relying exclusively on serial knowledge from previous episodes, but instead by relying on knowledge established within an individual episode itself, or by blending episodic and serial knowledge. And this is somewhat surprising, considering how much scholarly attention has been paid to viewers' cumulative serial engagement with characters. Granted, serial-enriched situations are incredibly powerful, and are one of serialized or partly serialized contemporary television's unique narrative features, at least in comparison with other media like film. However, patterns of blended and episodic enrichment in Mad Men Season 5 indicate that, at least for some television shows, seriality is perhaps less crucial than we might have assumed for engaging us as active mind readers, in Jason Mattel's terms. Regardless, though, serial enrichment still remains a powerful tool for television creators, given that blended situations become increasingly prominent as the season progresses. This pattern suggests that serial enrichment is important for providing a sense of closure, and that serial enrichment's relative scarcity early on makes its impact more pronounced later in the season, also providing a narratologically self-sufficient impetus for considering a season as a unit of television. More broadly, this exploration of Mad Men Season 5 points in the directions of future research, which can further illuminate how narratives function in contemporary TV. A logical next step is to examine how other seasons of Mad Men compare to the fifth season. It's possible that different seasons vary the ratios of episodic and blended enrichment, perhaps increasing the reliance on serial knowledge in later seasons, particularly in the final season, where all plot lines and characters draw to a close. However, given that throughout its entire run, Mad Men incorporated fairly episodic developments into season-long plot lines and character arcs, I think it seems more likely that the ratio of episodic to blended enrichment in other seasons, it's going to resemble that of the fifth season as well, both in terms of the average ratio of blended to episodic enrichment, and in terms of the gradual increase in blended enrichment as the season progresses. I think even more intriguing would be to examine how different television shows compare to one another along these lines. A likely hypothesis is that different series develop their own norms for their balance between episodic, serial, and blended enrichment, and that these norms are likely correlated with a show's overall degree of serialization. The more serialized a show is, the more psychologically rich situations are created through incorporating serial knowledge. Such an analysis might also take into account differences in distribution format. Series where episodes are released in bulk, like those distributed through Netflix and Amazon, could show marked differences from those airing on network and cable television, if such series take into account increased potential for cluster or binge viewing habits. Although it's equally likely that such series also accord with at least some of the norms and craft practices of episodic storytelling still commonplace in network and cable television. And finally, further inquiries could also yield industrial, technological, or economic explanations for differences in how series create psychologically rich situations. These are considerations I've only touched on briefly here. Or they could also explore the potential for historical differentiation in series from different eras. Ultimately, though, discovering how different television series develop their own norms for their balance between episodic, serial, and blended enrichment, I think that provides a useful framework for considering how television narratives make use of one of their most unique and appealing characteristics, namely the great degree of sophistication, nuance, and precision that viewers can attribute to the mental lives of characters. And that is all I've got for you. Oh, that's extra. Oh,
Any questions?
When you say more serialized, I think you answered that, but you mean coming out like every week rather than all at once? Do you mean by more serialized or?
No, I mean like there is more attention paid to plots that span episodes, or like episodes pick up right where the last one left off.
Oh, I see what you're saying.
The ultimate example being perhaps a daytime soap. Where you don't really have a lot of episodic arcs, they're all serialized. I don't know, because I don't watch daytime soap, so I don't want to say that with a lot of supreme confidence, but that would be one example.
I think I want you to speculate a little bit on where you concluded here. Just off the top of your head, I know you haven't done the research, do you think there's genre difference?
I do.
And difference in time, in terms of time period?
I think the latter, yes, definitely. I think probably early television, you reset every episode, right? The Honeymooners is always, always going to be bang, zoom, straight to the moon, Dallas, right?
Right.
Not much going on there, serialized. I think that's something that you to look for. I don't know. I think in our contemporary moment, there's probably greater variation than there's ever been before, and also greater potential for like extremes too, like even more serialized. So, yeah. There was another part of your question.
Do you think
genre? Oh, genre. Right. Yeah.
Yeah.
Probably, especially, think about something like Game of Thrones, right? You're working off of, each season is being adapted from a book or a part of a book. And so you have you got a lot of different plot lines going on in different places and different characters, each of which are serialized. I'd have to do the research. I'd have to watch the shows to be able to say one way or another. I mean, you look at something like Buffy, this is from a few years ago.
Yeah.
So this is a fantasy genre, a science fiction fantasy genre, but I think it's going to be a little more traditional. And there were seasonal plot arcs, but also it was very heavily emphasized in the episode as well. And then, you have, this is also pay cable, Girls on HBO, and Netflix's Orange is the New Black. Those things factor into this too. That's part of what I'm going to be looking at next, actually.
Yeah.
The way bulk release narratives do this sort of thing. I think I might take a look at Jessica Jones and Transparent and see how they're bearing these ratios between what information they're calling on to create rich situations.
I wonder if there isn't also a link to perceived prestige, that some one array or combination of narrative patterns.
Maybe. But like Mad Men is one of the most prestigious shows out there, right? And yet it's like largely episodic, but to a degree, with patterns that I just talked about.
Yeah.
So I think prestige also involves like accessibility to a certain degree, and serialization is less accessible because of you have to invest and you have to know all this stuff. So maybe, I don't know. I think the link there might be other factors involved in prestige more so than what I'm talking about today, but as far as pleasure is concerned, I think this factors into that very much. As I said, it's like serial knowledge, it rewards you, it pays off your investment. By drawing on that stuff, it's like, oh yeah, I know all about this. Like I was so thrilled at the end of season 5 of Mad Men. I thought, oh, perfect. It was like the perfect way. It's like a video, if you ever show somebody eating food and you reverse it, like they put the last spoon down and like they create the perfect sundae. Because like, that's what that was. Like, that was the perfect cherry on top of it. It's like, the mix of indifference and intrigue in his eyes when he turns to look at her. It's like, you know what he's going to do because of everything that's built up to this point. It was amazing. I was like ecstatic by the end of that season. Probably got like leapt off my couch and was like, yes! Or something. So it's very rewarding. That's the point of what I'm saying.
When Steve mentioned, when you mentioned time or the time period, I was thinking more of the time period of that it takes place in, and I wonder if that makes a difference. In other words, if it's more historical, then there might be more information that is fed to the audience to kind of bring them up to speed on the history versus a contemporary piece. Is that ever?
I can see it going both ways, yeah. Honestly. I mean, if you have to do a lot of work to establish the setting of the period, then yes, that can really enrich a later situation when you don't need to do all that work again.
Right.
Something like Outlander, which I haven't watched, but it takes place in like Scotland or in the distant past. What, is that right?
Yeah.
Yeah, in the distant past. So presumably there's a lot of establishment you're going to have to do of just political information. And that you get out of the way once, and that can really enrich stuff. But in terms of like character interactions and behavior, which is largely what I'm focusing on, I think that period is irrelevant because it's just the, like, all of this richness, we didn't necessarily have to know that this was set in the 60s to appreciate it. It was all interpersonal behavior. So that, I think, is timeless. Yeah.
Do you think that kind of knowledge adds to one's enjoyment of the type of film? Because I know, like, my family members who watch Mad Men, who, like, lived through that period, appreciated it so much more by how realistic it was.
I think it creates a new lens through which to view the show. I think that is a distinctive pleasure that you can get out of it, but it's different from the one I'm talking about. That is one where, yeah, there's different sorts of, that's like highly personal and like, that's a lived experience thing, so it's a slightly different move from what I'm talking about, but it's definitely part of it, yeah.
Have you noticed that since streaming's become so more popular, instead of bulk streaming, just like, you're able to get episodes of the past season more easily, that television shows are becoming more episodic based because of that, or more season?
I thought about that. I think that, television producers are making television for the format that they're airing their shows originally. Mad Men, Matt Weiner and the creators of Mad Men know it's going to be airing seasonal units and weekly basis, right? That's who they're tailoring their storytelling. They're not telling it for future audiences that might watch them all together at once.
Yeah.
Maybe those future audiences will not have the privilege of watching the Zen cones of what's going to happen next time on Mad Men. Those trailers for next time on Mad Men, it's always the people going like, what? Yes. Sit down. It's like, you don't get a scene, you just get like reactions to things. So that was a pleasure. But no, I think that producers of any media make it for the audience that exists now. And you get the same thing with like Reliance on Star Persona, for example. You might rely on viewers having knowledge of who Arnold Schwarzenegger is if you cast this film. You don't care whether or not 100 years from now anybody's going to know who that is. So it's that people want to get people invested now. So I think that we also see the difference with some of the shows that are designed to be released that way.
Have you separated serial knowledge, which comes from previous seasons, and then serial knowledge, which comes from earlier in that season?
That's this slide right here.
Oh, okay. Sorry.
So in orange we've got
the current season.
The previous season is in blue, and then a blend of both is in gray. So you see, it relies more and more on orange, that's season 5 info as it goes along. So that's resolving seasonal plots. But at the same time, it's still drawing on stuff from the past all along from past seasons. Yeah.
I'm not sure exactly how to ask the question, but I would love to hear you talk more about what you're doing here with duration, right? So you're measuring duration, you're talking about our experience of richness and pleasure, right, and the satisfaction that we get, and sort of how that's related to duration. But then I'd like to hear more. So like that fleeting moment that got you to leap off the couch, right? It's such a quick moment. So I feel like our intensities and intimacies and attachments aren't necessarily measured by like length of duration, right?
Yeah.
Can you talk about that a little bit? Like how you're sort of thinking about sort of the quantification of duration and how that's sort of related to pleasure and your
Yeah, I can go through my methodology a little bit here. Maybe this will clear up some of what you're talking about. I counted a scene, like I didn't distinguish situations from scenes, just for the simplicity of accumulating data. So I counted a scene as being serially enriched if it called on past information at all, at any point. And you know, scenes can vary in their richness, like they can become more rich as they progress. If it called out anything, I counted it as serial knowledge. So, and this was most easy when it called out knowledge of previous inferences. So, oh, I know Betty felt this way at this time. I can bring that to bear here. It was most clear cut then. It was less clear cut with dispositions. Dispositions aren't serial. It's like how the character is. And so I only really counted that as serial when it when it informed new ways in which characters were engaging with other characters, or when it informed ways in which characters kind of changed their dispositions. And I got an example of this, actually. This is, it was what, at the end of a, dispositional knowledge occasionally rises to the fore, and it serially enriches a situation, like when characters demonstrate a change in dispositions. So, for instance, in Dark Shadows, Don is insecure over an idea for an ad campaign, and he's competitive with the idea of one of his junior copywriters, Michael. Scenes dealing with this plot are somewhat enriched through the contrast that they provide with Don's longtime dispositions, where he hardly ever demonstrates insecurity or competitiveness. And later in the episode, he treats Michael poorly, which is marginally serially enriched by his having treated Peggy similarly in the past. Here, he's found a new character to heap familiar psychological abuses on. So while blended or serial enrichment most often refers to knowledge from previous mental states, I also designated scenes as being serially enriched when it provides a contrast, when their dispositions provide a contrast in behavior, and when their dispositions inform new ways that they meet with other characters. But to answer your larger point, really I'm not thinking of pleasure necessarily in terms of how much time something engages us. I'm thinking merely in terms of, pleasure is so, it's hard to quantify at all. I'm not trying to quantify pleasure. I'm just saying that this kind of stuff is pleasurable, and I wanted to track how often it happens over the course of the season, because this is one way in which we can be rewarded. Like really knowing what's happening inside of somebody else's head, that's really rewarding. When we're watching television, I know how this character's going to react, I know how this makes them feel, I can see on their performance what they're doing, and what they're thinking about, all these past things that we know, like when Betty's like reading that letter, you know what that feels like for her, because we know all this stuff. So I'm looking more at like how often does that happen, less so about how long it takes. I think it's an interesting question to ask, how much time can that feeling extend for in the scene itself? I'm not sure how to answer it necessarily. I think it's an interesting research question to look at, but it's not one I've asked yet. Yeah. Thanks. Where's my pen? Other questions?
I want to ask really briefly about first seasons of a TV show and how that might, you gestured to it a little bit, but I just wonder what sort of your ideas are on that, because I'm thinking about that graph that you shared about what it looks like in the beginning of season 5, and it's all reliant on season 4 knowledge. So what happens in season 1, right? And because I'm also thinking about, I think something is really important is maintaining audience, maintaining viewership, right? And so I think partially this is why it tends to kind of stay within the season, right? And to sort of like, oh, if you just pop in now, you don't need to know season 4, 3, 2, and 1. You can like kind of watch from then on. And so I wonder about season 5.
Well, I haven't done I haven't looked at the numbers or like watched the show, but yeah, I think it would resemble strongly what we've seen here. More, although season 1 of Mad Men is different, because I think season 1 relies more on psychologically poor situations rather than, but not necessarily more than psychologically rich situations, but there are a greater number of poor situations, because for a large part of season 1, we don't know about his past. Mm-hmm. We don't know why he answers the phone, this is Dick Whitman, and he's been like, that name has been anathema to him for so long. I think that might be in season 2. But there's a greater, there's some mysteries that the show is kind of dangling out and parsing out. So I think that it would probably be more like, they're like psychologically rich situations, there'd be higher numbers, or poor situations, those would be higher in the beginning and dwindle as the mysteries got resolved. And as we learn more about that, that would correspond with the rise in blended enrichment, or not blended, serial enrichment.
But that's super interesting then, because then it's not about knowledge, it's about the lack of knowledge, right? It's about a mystery, not about something that you know that then you can connect back to another season or within the same season, right? It's about what you don't know.
It's another way of intriguing viewers. And some shows draw that out, not just with character history, but with the plot, Lost being a prime example.
Exactly. Yeah.
To greater or lesser success sometimes. But yeah, that can be hard to do, I feel like, because Lost had problems, and people were not completely 100% satisfied with that show. And I think we saw a lot of shows that tried to imitate it by throwing it on the air and fail, because people were not willing to have faith in the showrunners. Um, Yeah, I think, like, in general, though, a first season of a television show, this is something I'm going to be looking at in the future, probably becomes more and more reliant on serial knowledge as it progresses, for the same reasons that this season does.
Yeah.
It gives us a sense of closure, it kind of gives us a sense of the season as a unit of narrative, and it rewards viewers who've watched the entire season, and encourages new viewers to go back and watch the previous episodes. If you just happen to catch one. I don't really think people watch television out of order anymore. Maybe they do a little bit, but...
Buffy would be different.
Yeah, Buffy would be different. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yes?
You talk about different models. I'm thinking specifically of the British model, Sherlock, where you have basically three episodes, and that's the series, and maybe a Christmas special months later, and yet you're building up serial knowledge just over a longer period of time in shorter spans.
I haven't thought about it, but now that I'm thinking about it right now, I think that it would be much more episodic. I mean, we've got, those are basically movies. Each episode is like a movie, right? They're like 90 minutes to 2 hours. I've seen the first two of the first season. And so you're focused largely, I assume, most of the time on whatever mystery Sherlock is trying to solve. And it probably functions a lot more like a show like Buffy, quite honestly, where you've got kind of ongoing serial arcs, but there's always the monster of the week that she needs to defeat. There's always the mystery of the episode Sherlock needs to solve. Most of the screen time will probably be spent on that, with some serial bits thrown into the margins. That would be my guess, having only seen two episodes of Sherlock and deciding I didn't want to watch.
I think there's actually a lot of serial fan investment in the relationships that occur over time. And that's an added factor that comes into this, the depth of the fandom and how they influence the series.
Even more interesting, I think we're seeing some of this even in feature films, the Marvel Cinematic Universe, for example.
Yeah.
The new Avengers film is going to call on information from the previous two Avengers films. Or rather, the new Captain America film. You can see it in the trailer. It assumes you've seen the previous films, that you know what's happening.
Or the TV show.
Agent Carter or Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D.
Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. is that what it's called?
Yeah.
Which relies on you knowing the movies.
Yeah, it's kind of like The Matrix Reloaded, right? Which relied on you having planned to enter the Matrix.
Yeah.
Will it maybe ahead of time? Other questions? Comments? Thoughts?
Okay, I'd like to thank you all for coming out. And again, let's thank Jason for his